Okay, let me do another one-take video here. Hi, everyone, Steve Dangle, and there is Leafs news. The Leafs, yesterday, they put Travis Boyd on waivers, and today, sorry if it sounds like I'm repeating myself, Travis Boyd was claimed by the Vancouver Canucks. So, twice in about a week, the Leafs lose two players now to the Vancouver Canucks on waivers. Now, there's going to be a lot of spin, and there's reasons that this could be good, I suppose. Cap space is big. Everyone's expecting the Leafs to make a move. I'm sorry. I cannot find a way to put a positive spin on the Leafs losing three players to waivers in the same season. And you might be going, three? Aaron Dell! So remember we were talking about the goaltending situation and all that? Aaron Dell was claimed off of waivers by the New Jersey Devils before the season even began. Then Jimmy Vesey, who was in the starting lineup, was on John Tavares' line to start the season. And William Nylander's is claimed off waivers by the Canucks. And now Travis Boyd claimed off waivers by the Canucks as well. So let's talk about Travis Boyd and the season that he had. He did not start this season on the Leafs. I want to say he started it on the taxi squad. He didn't make the opening night lineup. Then he scores. What? He scores in his first game. And you might look at his numbers and go, I'm sorry, how the heck can't this guy help the Leafs? He has 8 points in 20 games, pretty much exclusively as a fourth liner. Well, scores in his first game. He had an assist in one of those, one of the next games, and then two assists in another. So half of his points came in his first three games. So there's that. He did have a two-point performance in one of the Leafs' recent games against the Oilers. But other than that, I think he went pointless in his final nine games as a Leaf. So, yes, he's definitely a capable scorer, especially as a depth guy, and I would rather the Leafs have him than didn't, but a half a point a game player consistently, I think that's a little bit much. In fact, I know he is an interesting figure in the stats community. Dom Lecision is always tweeting about him because over his entire career, his personal PDO is off the charts. So what's that? PDO used to be called the luck metric. That's not a great way of explaining it anymore. But basically, PDO is shooting percentage plus save percentage. You expect it to be around 100. Travis Boyd was operating at like a 103. It was ridiculous. The puck always went in for his team when he was on the ice, and it stayed out of his net when he was on the ice. So we were all really happy to have him. And when the season started, obviously, the 4 points in his first three games, who the heck is this guy? Now, I want to give you an idea of how good the Leafs' depth was. It's still pretty good, but here's how good the Leafs, like, out of the lineup, barely making the lineup depth was. I said this recently. I haven't checked it in about a week, but the Sabres recently started a first line. I believe it was, this is the Buffalo Sabres, was of Taylor Hall, Riley Sheahan, and Tage Thompson. They iced that as their first line. The fourth line for the Leafs of VC, Boyd, and Spezza, two of which are now Canucks, had more points on the season than them. And they were fourth liners pretty much exclusively all season. VC sort of up and down. Spezza used on the third very sparingly, occasionally, maybe a shift or two on the first or second playing on the wing. And Travis Boyd, I want to say he got a mini audition in the top six when the Leafs had a bunch of injuries, eventually losing that spot to Wayne Simmonds. So, with all those points that Boyd had earlier in the season, and he didn't make the lineup right away, Sheldon Keefe was looking for a fourth line that he liked. And he would, hey, here's this combination this night, take some guys out of the lineup, try this guy. And Boyd won. He straight up won a spot, and he was able to hold on to it for a while. But, like I said, eight of his final nine games as a Leaf, he didn't have a point. And you don't expect your fourth line to score every night, but the problem with him that I found is I stopped trusting him defensively. He'd had a bunch of giveaways. They would leave the goals almost exclusively in the neutral zone. I found a lot of neutral zone turnovers. And it's just not a good look for a fourth line. And it's certainly not indicative of a guy who's like an everyday fourth line player on a team that should be really difficult to make. He's good. he's good, he'll help the Canucks. VC's good, he'll help the Canucks. And there's built-in chemistry. Like, there's no situation to me where this is bad for the Canucks. Guys on a league min contract, 700 grand, VC 900 grand, math, 800 grand on average for those two. But basically, you acquire two-thirds of the fourth line of a team that's been in first in the division for basically all season, and you didn't have to give up any assets for it. What's wrong with that? And especially considering the quarantine situation going on in Canada, this is really good. This is really good for the Canucks. You can chirp them all you want on Twitter about what this means about the team that, you know, they have all these waiver claims. Well, it doesn't matter. First of all, how many of us spend so much time on Twitter going, I hope this guy gets claimed. I hope my team claims this guy. And now the Canucks have claimed two from the same team for cheap, for free. It's only good for them. Vancouver Canucks fans will love this guy. Now, for the Leafs, though, you know, Steve, you're kind of tugging me in different directions. You're saying this guy's good, but you're saying why you shouldn't be in the lineup every day. This is a unique season. There's no scenario where it's good to lose three guys on waivers in the same season. But because this season is different, maybe the Canucks don't get to do this in a regular season. Maybe they don't see the need to in a regular season because they can claim guys from 30 different teams instead of just like six, basically. Where was I going with that? This is the struggle with one-takers. I'm not going to let this go. Oh, here we go. The Leafs still have Alexander Barabanov, who they had in the minors, and he was good. Alex Galchenyuk is now in the lineup. Wayne Simmons is back from injury. Nick Patan, happy birthday to Nick Patan, by the way. He's still an option for the Leafs. Adam Brooks is in the minors. He's still an option for the Leafs. Nick Robertson is in the minors. He's still an option for the Leafs. And these are just guys up front. Tyler Gaudette hasn't gotten much of a sniff. Kenny Agostino played a game. So basically the Leafs are nowhere close to being out of depth options up front for forwards. They have honestly like six lines I would trust in the NHL. Three of those lines, ideally would be fourths, but they're still in a really good position. I want to see Nick Robertson on this team, man, but that's a whole other story. It's never good to lose those guys, but I think the Leafs, we know, like with the whole Josh Levo scenario, where he ended up in Vancouver, by the way, after all of that, we know with the Josh Levo scenario that if the Leafs really, really, really want to protect a guy, or they feel like they can't lose a guy, they'll find a way to keep that guy. With Jimmy Vesey and with Travis Boyd, they felt safe enough that, you know what, we can expose these guys. Ideally, we put them on the taxi squad, still frees up some cap space, and if we lose them, what are you going to do? So, in this scenario, what are you going to do? Well, with Jimmy Vesey, you lost your fourth-line left winger, basically, and part of the power play. And with Travis Boyd, a guy who is exclusively a fourth-liner for the team, pretty much, except for one game he was randomly on the first power play this year, and Joe Thornton set him up for his first career NHL power play goal. It's been that kind of season. It's very weird. I'm waiting for more news to come. It's trickling in. The Leafs, again, have a major break. They have four straight off days. This is day number, I don't even know, because it's been that kind of season. Frederik Andersen sounds like he might be going on IR. I don't know what the cap implications are there. Ian Scott, I think, was called up to the Leafs or called up to the taxi squad. For those of you who are like, who the hell is that, by the way? He's a Leaf draft pick. I want to say fifth rounder a couple years ago. Ended up winning WHL Goalie of the Year. Like, he's really good. Unfortunately, I think he had to have hip surgery or some sort of lower body surgery. And due to the recovery of that and also COVID, I don't know if you heard about COVID, he's barely had an opportunity to play any pro hockey or even get in pro hockey practice. So I think he's just a body there. He's a rehabilitation project. If they put him in net for any NHL games, even in an emergency scenario, I think it would be a huge mistake and just an injustice to the poor guy. My God, let him face some NHL shots in practice before you go feed him to the Wolves. They won't even do that to Joseph Woll, who has been playing professional hockey anyway. So leave a comment in the comment box down below. Feel like this has gone on long enough. What are your thoughts on Travis Boyd getting claimed by the Vancouver Canucks? Are you like, Steve, how are you able to do this for that long? This video probably could have been shorter. I know, will you do it? Well, no, I don't want to. That's why I watch you. Well, then shut up! I'm sorry. Anyway, that is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really liked it. Tell all your friends. Sorry, you've been claimed on waivers. You're a Canuck now. Oh. And this is the part where I have to click it. I'm not editing it. Right.